morning, everyone. So today we are going to start with sequential circuits, and let us see how it goes. If it gets over early, I wanted to actually talk about some other topics as well. So sequential circuits, of course, start with a latch, and we will come to this latch earlier. But before that, let's just go through a little bit of motivation for the students. Why do you want to study sequential circuits? How are they different from combinatorial circuits? So the digital circuits we have seen so far, and that was yesterday, gates, multiplexers, demultiplexers, encoders, decoders, etc. They're all combinatorial in nature. And what does that mean? That means the outputs depend only on the present values of the inputs and not on their past values. So in other words, these circuits really do not have a history or a memory embedded in them, and that is why they're called combinatorial circuit. It just depends on what combination of inputs you apply at the input, and does not matter in what sequence you apply those. So that is why they are called combinatorial circuits. In sequential circuits, the state of the circuit is crucial, and you know all that. In a JK flip-flop, for example, its output will depend on what the state was in the earlier before the clock came. So the state of the circuit is crucial in determining the output values. For a given input combination, a sequential circuit may produce different output values depending on its previous state. So in that sense, the sequential circuits have a memory. So in other words, the sequential circuit has a memory of its past state, whereas a combinatorial circuit has no memory. Okay. So that is the basic difference between sequential circuits and combinatorial circuits. All right, why do we want to bother with sequential circuits? Because they are just about everywhere. Sequential circuits together with combinatorial circuits make it possible to build several useful applications, such as counters, registers, arithmetic logic unit, that is ALU, all the way to microprocessor. If you look at a microprocessor, it has got the clock is a predominant part of a microprocessor, and the clock is there because there are lots of sequential circuits inside, including the program counter and so on. All right, so let's get to the most basic block of a sequential circuit, and that is a latch. And a latch you can make either with NAND gates or with NOR gates, and this is called an RS latch. And let me just what I'll do is I'll just work this, because the resolution is probably not good enough for you. I'll just write this on the paper, and let's go from there. Okay, so we have this latch. And the difference between this and what we have seen in the combinatorial circuits is immediately clear. There is a feedback path from the output to some inputs, and that is what makes this circuit have memory, right? Okay, now what is R, what is S, what is Q, what is Q bar? What one approach is we say that okay, this terminal is R, that terminal is S, and Q and Q bar and so on. But that is not very satisfying. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call these some arbitrary names, A and B. I'm going to call this Q, and I'm going to call this Q bar. All right. So now let us see what happens if I apply certain combinations of A and B. Okay, so the first combination I take is A equal to 1, B equal to 0. All right, now very often it is possible to just state this entire table without actually showing why what is what and why how it comes about. But of course, as I said, it is not very satisfactory. It's always good to, since the students already know about NAND gates, it is always good to explain to them that this is indeed what you will expect and not just state it. Okay, so A is equal to 1, B equal to 0, and if B is 0, immediately we have Q bar equal to 1. This is Q bar. Yeah. We have Q bar equal to 1. If Q bar is 1, that is getting fed back over here. So we have 1 here, and that is why we have 0 here. So this entry of the table we can complete. Okay, just based on NAND gates, right? Without actually knowing what this table is going to be beforehand. So it's always good to start from the basics in that sense. Okay. 0. Let's take A equal to 0, B equal to 1 now, and we can show that this is going to be 1 and this is going to be 0. What about A equal to 1, B equal to 1? Now this state is sort of tricky because this is something that the students are coming across for the first time. And what, so let's worry about just this part. Let me just circle this, A equal to 1, B equal to 1, and let me get rid of this, okay. So in this case, let's see if 0, 1 is possible, okay. So if this is 1, that 1 goes here, this is also 1, so this is 0, this is 0, and therefore this is 1. So this state is possible, so 0, 1 is possible. And by the same procedure, we can also show that 1, 0 is possible as well, okay. So 0, 1 is possible, 1, 0 is possible. So which one of these things will prevail? All right. So that depends on what these things were in the past. So we say previous. All right. Note that so far we haven't even talked about the clock, but the clock we should bring in at some point. It is best not to bring it in the beginning, because the idea of this latch is independent of the clock as such. The clock is just a synchronizing convenience that we add later on, okay. So it's always good to describe this, just this latch. And so in that sense, this circuit has latched in these previous value. If your inputs are going to be 1 1, this previous value gets latched in forever, right, unless now there is some change in A and B. What about 0, 0? If these are both 0, then Q will become equal to 1 and Q bar will also equal to 1. And as you know, this state actually we do not allow. Why don't we allow that? First of all, is Q and Q bar are not complementary. That is just one of the reasons. But there is another very important reason that we will come to little later. Okay, now just looking at this table, now we need to figure out why, what we should call A and what we should call B, right. So here what we need to introduce the concept of a latch getting set and latch getting reset. All these things, remember that at this point the student has not really heard. So even when you say set, we already know what it means, but the student does not know. So latch getting set means Q is becoming 1. Latch getting reset means Q is equal to, means Q is becoming 0, right. So now knowing this, now we need to figure out what values of A and B will set the latch, what values of A and B will reset the latch, and then we can figure out what A is and what B is. So if you notice, A is 1, if A is active and B is not active, the latch is getting reset. So therefore, A must be the R input. Similarly, if B is active, A is not active, the latch is getting set. So therefore, the B must be the S input, okay. So instead of just writing R S in the beginning, it is always better to call these some arbitrary names A and B and show that this indeed must be R and this indeed must be S. That's much more satisfying from the student's perspective, okay. Instead of just giving the student some magic table, it is better to derive that table from first principles. All right, so two important points here. This 1 1 input gives you a previous it gives you the same state as the previous one. In other words, the latch continues its previous state, and this 0 0 is not allowed, okay. And we'll come back to this 0 0 business a little later, okay. So let's get back to this slide. So this slide is nothing but what we have just discussed. Just a continuation of the same thing. All right. So at the end of this slide, we say that the A input is therefore called the reset input or R input, and B is called set input. Okay. So let's consider this further, and maybe again the resolution problem would be there. So I'll just draw this on paper, this waveform. All right. So the important thing is why don't we allow this R equal to zero, S equal to zero entry? So let's take another look at that. Okay. So here we have the latch. Okay, this is R, this is S, right. So we have seen earlier, R is 1, S is 0, Q is reset, R is 0, S is 1, Q is set, 1, 1, previous state, and 0, 0, not allowed. Now, so this is the entry that we want to look at in some more detail, and see why is it not allowed. So let's take some waveform. Okay, I'm going to plot R, S, Q and Q bar. So you have all this in your slide, but let me just draw it here because you may not be able to see. This is R given. Okay, this is S also given, and we are given that this input Q is 1 in the beginning and Q bar is 0. Okay. So the transition points are these. Transition point means the points at which things may change, may or may not change. Okay, so let's start with at this point. S is 1, R is 0, so therefore Q is 1, and that will continue all the way up to here. Now, when we cross this, right, S and R are both becoming 1, and the latch will just hold on to its previous state. And all this time, of course, Q bar is actually 0. Q bar is 0. Okay, at this point what happens is R becomes 1, S becomes 0, so therefore the latch gets reset. It is always good to work this out in class, so the students have some idea about the applications immediately in terms of the actual time domain. Okay, so let me extend this a little bit further. We are now going to the next slide. But that's okay. Let me just write it here. After this, R and S are both become 1. So this will continue its present state. This also Q bar will also continue. And at this point, let's say R and S both become 0. Okay, R has become 0, S has become 0. Right. Okay. And at this point, let's say R and S have become 1, 1 again. 1 and okay, so now it's very clear. Like we said before, if you have 0, 0 here, definitely the gate outputs are both going to be 1. So here we have a 1, and here we have a 1. Okay, so that is the state of affairs at this point. Right. Now at this particular time instant, R and S are both going to 1. Okay. So now the question is, what should we take as the previous state? Big question. Now there is no unique answer to that, and what will happen finally is the flip. This latch will either reach the state Q equal to 1 or Q equal to 0, depending on the internal delays of these two NAND gates. Right? And that, of course, is so. There is a big question mark here. What will happen next? Right? And this kind of uncertainty, of course, we don't like in digital circuits at all, because we would like for a known set of inputs, you would like known outputs. So therefore, this is not allowed. So Yeah, this figure is not looking quite all right, but if you look at the slides, you will see see it much better. So that is the reason R and R equal to 0, S equal to 0 is not allowed. Okay, so let's go get back to the document, and this slide will essentially just see what we have done just now. So at this point, we have these question marks which we don't like. Okay, there's the NOR NAND gate, NAND latch. Similarly, we can make a NOR latch, and once again, we can, instead of calling this R and S, we can actually call it A and B first, and show that this will turn out to be R, this will turn out to be S, and so on. And so, I've not shown all of those figures, but you can do that in on the board if you like when you teach. So, in this case, that things are pretty similar. R is 1, S is 0 will reset the flip flop or the latch. R is 0, S is 1 will set the flip flop, set the latch. Okay. There was a question on Moodle yesterday about what is the difference between a latch and a flip flop. So we'll come to that. But essentially, a latch can have a level clock. So latch is a level triggered device, whereas a flip flop is an edge triggered device. So that is the difference. We'll come back to this point later. Alright, so this latch is the first two entries are identical. Now, in this particular case, R equal to S equal to 0 will give you the previous state, whereas R equal to 1, S equal to 1 is invalid. So, in this, in the last two entries, it is different than the NAND latch. It is important to point this out, and in fact, it is even better to have these together at the same point so that the students can compare. So, the first two entries 1, 0. The latch is reset, 1, 0, the latch is reset, 0, 1, the latch is set, 0, 1, the latch is set. So, these two are identical, and the next two entries are actually different. So, here 1, 1 gives you the previous state, here 0, 0 gives you the previous state. So, it is good to put this together so that the students have a ready reference for making out the difference and the similarities between these two latches. Okay, it's good to point out an application of this RS latch, and in electronics, if you have a mechanical switch, there is something called chatter or bouncing, and it's an RS latch can actually help in preventing that that from happening. Okay, okay, it's the resolution may be a little low here for you, so I'll leave this to you. You can just go through this slide, and you can. So this is what happens in the latch. You can probably see this graph at least. So what we are doing is VO versus T in this figure. What we are doing is there is a switch here which goes from this position A to position B, right? So and at B we have this voltage source, and at A we have this ground. So the expected output voltage is 0 up to this point, and at T equal to 0 the switch goes to position B, and therefore it should be the source voltage at this point. What actually happens in practice is that there is some chatter, and then the switch position will actually be will not immediately go to 1, but there will be some moments when it is actually in the air, not connected anywhere. So, and that will show up as a 0 volt in this VO versus time if you expand this on the millisecond scale. Now, this is a chatter that we want to avoid. For example, if you are feeding this to a counter, you will actually be counting erroneously, right? You will be counting more than what you should count. So, this is a chatter that we want to get rid of, and an RS flip flop can actually help in this case. So, what we have done here is this part is the same, A and B. This is 5 volts, this is also 5 volts, and the ground is connected to the center of the switch. The pole of the switch. Okay, and then we have an RS flip flop, and that is the table that we have seen before. And in, I guess this is the NAND latch because we have 1-1 showing as the previous Q. Alright, so what happens is now this S and R inputs will have this bouncing effect. So S will go like that, R will go like that, but because it is because of flip flop properties, when S is 1. And R is when R is 1 and S is 0, the flip flop is 0. And when S becomes 1 and R becomes 1, the flip flop the latch actually does not change; it remains 0. Similarly, when S is 1, this R is undergoing some bouncing, and so that gives you either R equal to 0 or R equal to 1. So the moment R becomes 0, the the latch will get set, and R equal to 1, S equal to 1 actually does not cause a problem because you are just in the previous state. So therefore, you still have the latch will retain its previous state, and therefore this will remain 1. So now you have a clean transition from 0 to 1, and that is how you can. These things are actually used in digital circuits. If you are comparing some things and based on that driving some further circuitry, this is a good latch to have. Okay, so it's good to just point out an application to students at this point. Right, the clock. Okay, why do we need the clock? So it's because complex digital circuits are generally designed for synchronous operation, because it just makes the design procedure much easier. That is, transitions in with the various signals are synchronized with the clock. So what is a clock? It's basically it serves to synchronize the various operations in a microprocessor or in a complex digital circuit. And why do we worry about synchronous circuits? Because they are easier to design and troubleshoot, because the voltages at the nodes, both the output nodes and the internal nodes of the circuit, can change only at specific times, and that is why it's all of these processors will have a clock signal. A clock is a periodic signal with a positive going transition and a negative going transition. So now this periodic does not mean that it has to be it has to have a duty cycle of 50%, it can have different duty cycles. But the important thing is that each clock cycle has a positive going edge and a negative going edge. So since the students have not really come across these words at this point, it is good to point out that there is such a thing called a positive going edge, in which the clock goes from 0 to 1. There is such a thing called negative going edge, in which the clock goes from 1 to 0. Okay, and the clock frequency of course is extremely important, because it determines the overall speed of the circuit. For example, a processor that operates with 1 gigahertz is 10 times faster than one that operates with 100 megahertz. And of course, we have seen this revolution in processors. What in 10 years ago we probably did not even have 1 gigahertz processor, but now we have already more than 2.5 or whatever. And the computer, therefore the speed, the things that you can do with your computer now have changed. All right, so now we come to a clocked RS latch, and of course you are all familiar with this. So although you cannot probably view this, although this resolution may be a slight problem, I hope you can at least see this figure clearly. So this is your previous latch, and now I have called this A and called this B and not R and S. So let me explain why. Let me just go back to the paper. Okay, so here is your NAND latch, the old one. This is connected to another NAND gate. So this is your clock, right? And as I said, this is a latch, clock latch, and it is sensitive to the level of the clock and not the edge as flip flops are. This is your old friend, the NAND latch, and now I am going to not call this A, R and S, but A and B, because I would like to have my R and S outside this bigger box. This is still Q bar. So this box is the latch that we have seen before. This is the actual clock latch. Okay. All right, why did we call this A and B? Because we want to now name these things as R and S, and we don't, let us see which one is which. So for about this inner box, the NAND latch, we already know this. We know that if A is 1 and B is 0, Q is 0, Q bar is 1. If A is 0, B is 1, Q is 1, Q bar is 0. If A is 1, B is 1, then this is previous, and then 0, 0 is not allowed. Okay. Now, if clock is 1, then let us call this X and Y. If clock is 1, this A is actually X bar and B is Y bar. Now remember, this A is serving as the reset input and B is serving as a set input. So therefore, X bar is serving as the reset input and Y bar is serving as the set input. So in other words, if you want to name these things, we should actually name this as S and R. Right? So this should be S and this should be R. And then your overall flip-flop, if clock is equal to 1, will look like this, R, S. Then it will follow the same table as before. So R is 1, S is 0, the flip-flop gets reset. R is 0, S is 1, the flip-flop gets set. R is, alright, here is a point that we need to worry about. What happens if R is 1, S is 1? What happens if R is 0, S is 0? If R is 1, S is 1, then A and B actually become 0, 0, and that is not allowed. Right? So now the not allowed state is not 0, 0, but 1, 1. 0, 0, if S is 0, R is 0, this A and B will become 1, 1, and that, yes, that corresponds to this entry of the latch table, and then we have the previous state. Okay. What about clock equal to 0? Clock equal to 0 means A and B are both equal to 1, and therefore there is no change, and therefore as long as clock is 0, this latch does not change its state, and clock equal to 1 change, makes things happen. So that's why this is a level sensitive latch. Okay, so again, it's important to actually convince students that this must be the S terminal and this must be the R terminal, rather than just stating it. All right, let's go ahead. So that is what this slide is talking about. All right, and then there are some waveforms here, which are based on the table that we just derived. And a given R and given S. Right. So here is a clock signal. If you cannot view it too clearly, you can just get back to the slide later and see what it is doing. So if clock is 0, you can see that no change really happens. So the previous queue will actually continue, whether you are here or here or here and so on. The same queue will continue. So the previous value of Q will just continue. When clock is high, then the output can change depending on what R and S are. Okay. So at this stage, it is always good to show some waveforms to the students so that they can connect this latch with you know, some real circuit operation, rather than just going ahead with more and more flip-flops and boring the students. So it's better to just let them think a little bit about what happens in the time domain. Okay, edge triggered flip-flops. So this is the difference between flip-flops and latches. Flip-flops are edge-triggered. So the clock largest latch seen previously is level sensitive. That is, if the clock is active, the flip-flop output is allowed to change depending on the R and S inputs. We have already seen that, and we have seen an example of the waveforms. In an edge-triggered flip-flop, edge-sensitive flip-flop, the output can change only at the active edge of the clock. Now the active edge will depend on what kind of flip-flop it is. There are flip-flops which are triggered by positive edges. There are flip-flops which are triggered by negative edges. Okay. So here is an example. So an edge-triggered RS flip-flop will be denoted by this little triangle here. That means edge-triggered. And if there is a circle outside this triangle, then that makes it is a negative edge triggered flip flop. So this nomenclature is something that the students must understand very well. Okay. Now the table of a JK flip. So what is a JK flip flop? Here is a simple first circuit of a JK flip flop, and we will later find that there are some problems with this circuit. And since again this is the font is small, let me just write this on, reproduce this here on the paper. So we have the same NAND latch as we discussed before. This is our Q, this is Q bar. Now this is the input of this latch is coming from another NAND gate. Like that. Then there is a clock input. Then there is a J input and there is a K input. And then there is some feedback involved. So this Q bar is actually fed to this first NAND gate. Q is fed to the second NAND gate. Okay. And this whole thing is then called the JK flip flop. Okay. Why are we doing all this, taking all this trouble? Because there is a point that is to be made. Okay, so let's fill up some of these entries. Clock, J, K, and Q n plus 1. Now Q n plus 1 means the n plus 1th clock pulse. So if clock is 0, what do we have? We have 1 here. And we have 1 here, and then of course we know that this latch will keep its present state, previous state. So it does not matter what X, J is, it does not matter what K is, and this holds on to its previous state. In other words, it is the same as what Qn was. Okay, what if it's, what if the clock is 1 and this is 0 and this is 0? J is 0, K is 0, and this is still 1 and this is still 1. All the clock is 1, and this will still hold on to its previous state. What about 101? Now you can, so this is clock is 1, J is 0, K is 1. You actually can then work out what will happen. This 0 will immediately force a 1 here. And then you can take two possibilities and actually show that all this is done in the slide. And just go through this details. So you can, we can show that this will become 0. For clock high, this one J equal to 1 and K equal to 0, this will become 1. What happens if clock is 1, J is 1 and K is 1? That's an interesting case. So this is 1, this is clock is 1 and J is also 1. Alright. So now what will happen is if your Q bar was let's say Q bar was 0, this will become 1, and if your Q was so if Q bar was 1, Q would have been 0. Sorry, Q bar was 0, Q would have been 1, and this would become 0. This will give you Q q bar becoming 1. So q bar earlier was 0 and now it is becoming 1. So you can explain this in class, spend some more time for the students. So essentially you can show that this toggles, right? And that is a new entry. So previously we were not allowing these kinds of things, we were saying things not allowed and so on, but now in this particular flip-flop we are actually allowing it. Okay, but what the problem here in with this flip-flop is that if J is equal to K is equal to 1, right, we have seen that it has toggled. But now what happens? J and K are still 1, so it will toggle again. Okay, so let us say this, it was 0 first, Q equal to 0, then it became 1, again it became 0, again it become 1 and so on. So as long as J and K are 1, this will simply go on toggling, and that is what we do not want. So therefore this circuit actually has to be improved, and that actually has led to the master slave configuration. So you need to now the master slave configuration is a little too difficult to sort of cover in a basic course, because there are too many cases to consider and so on, but the motivation for that at least should be brought out by showing this these details. Okay, so that is what is done in this slide, what we just did on paper. Okay, so here is an important point. Consider J equal to K equal to 1. So as long as the clock is 1, Q will keep toggling, and that is something that we do not like. What is the frequency? The frequency will depend on the delay values of the various gates involved. Okay. So that is something that we do not want. So therefore we improve on this, and that leads us to the master slave configuration. You can just show the master slave configuration in class perhaps, but actually analyzing it will take you a long time, and I am not sure, it is not clear whether it is really worth it at this level. So you could just say that okay, this master and slave. The basic operation of the master and slave is like that. If when this clock is 1, then this latch is active, but this latch is still not affected, and only when the clock becomes 0, then this comes into picture, and therefore this whole operation, this whole flip-flop becomes sensitive to an edge, and it also gets rid of this problem that we just saw. So the in the table you will see that instead of clock equal to 1, now we have written a downward edge. I hope it is sort of visible to you. There is a downward edge here rather than saying 0 or 1, and that is the active edge, and that is when things can happen. Okay, so note that unlike the RS NAND latch, which does not allow one of the combinations of R and S, that was R equal to S equal to 0, the JK flip flop allows all 4 combinations, and that is a very big difference between JK and RS. And since the students are looking at this for the first time, it is important to emphasize this point. Okay, positive edge triggered and negative edge triggered flip flops, the transition tables are basically identical, except the active edge here is positive, the active edge here is negative. And of course the symbols are different. Here we do not have the circle for the clock, here we have the circle for the clock, because it is the negative edge that is active. Okay. Now just this is a very important point, and let us go through this slide in detail. So consider a negative edge triggered flip flop that is shown here. So as we have shown earlier, this flip flop has got a master latch and a slave latch, and the master gets clock whereas the slave gets clock bar, right. Now consider a clock like that. So as seen earlier, when clock is high, the input J and K determine the master latch output Q, right. So that means Q1 rather. So this Q1 is then determined by what are these inputs J and K, and all that will happen when clock is 1. Now since clock bar is 0, this slave output actually is not affected. You do not see any output, you do not see any change. There is a change in Q1, but that is not reflected in the output Q. So during this time no change is visible at the flip flop output Q, it is very important. When the clock goes low, the slave flip flop becomes active. So now the master is inactive, and the master has already done his job, it has changed Q1 and Q1 bar according to what J and K were. And now the master has become inactive, so no more changes will happen in master because the clock has gone to 0. clock bar has gone to 1, so therefore this changes that were affected were performed by the master will can now reflect in the flip flop output Q and Q bar. So when the clock goes low, then the slave flip flop becomes active, making it possible for Q and Q bar to change. All right. So the important point is that in short, although the flip flop output Q can only change after the active edge, right? What is the active edge here? The active edge is the negative edge. The new Q value is determined by J and K values just before the active edge. And why is that? Because just so this master has actually done its job just before the active edge happened, right? And that is why so the master will only look at J and K values just before the active edge. After the active edge, the master actually is inactive. It doesn't do anything. Right? So therefore, in order to determine the flip flop values Q and Q bar, we need to look at what was J and K just prior to this active edge. That's very important. Now, if you, I've seen students making all kinds of mistakes in the examinations and so on if they don't get this right. This is a very important point. You cannot really overemphasize that. Very, very important point. Okay, at this point it is good to give some waveforms. Okay, I hope you can at least see the waveforms, if not all these details. So there is a clock here, there is J and K, some sample values, and it shows what Q looks like. And this is a positive edge triggered flip flop, so things will change only at the positive edge of the clock. Okay. So J is 1 here, K is 0 here, so therefore Q has become 1. Remember, we are always looking at what happens just before the active edge, right? So the active edge is positive going, so we are looking at J and K values just before the positive edge here. At the next positive edge, so nothing happens before the next active edge. The next active edge comes along here, right, at this point, and just prior to that, J was 0, K was 0, and therefore the flip-flop continues to hold its state. Next active edge, J is 0, K is 1. So therefore, the flip-flop has changed its state to 0. Next active edge, just before the next active edge, J is 1, K is 1, and therefore the flip-flop has toggled, and so on. So if you show a figure like this at this point, it really serves to fix this this table in the student's mind. Otherwise, it just remains a table which has to be sort of mugged up and reproduced in the exam. It is not a satisfactory approach. Okay, now. The same inputs, but now the flip-flop is negative edge triggered. Then what happens? So you can go through this. Now things get aligned with the negative edge of the clock rather than the positive edge. And otherwise, since the inputs are actually similar, the output will not really change much. But this is an important difference. This these changes in the output here are aligned with the positive edge of the clock. Here it is aligned with the negative edge of the clock. There is a difference between positive edge and negative edge triggered flip flops. Okay, so here is an example that we have worked out. So let's do this on paper and just see in general how to go about analyzing this JK circuits involving JK flip flops. Okay, so let me just reproduce this figure on paper. So there is a simple circuit consisting of two flip flops. And they are positive edge triggered. So, okay. So this we will call as. Okay, let me call this as J1, J2, sorry, K1. J2, K2, Q1. Q1 bar, Q2, Q2 bar. Okay. Now the clock is the same for both flip flops, and let me show that here. It's driven by a common clock. Both of these are driven by a common clock. So this is the clock. Right. Okay. In this, in case of the first flip flop, J1 and K1 are both tied together, and they are tied to 1, so they are equal to 1. J2 and K2 It's like this. So we have a J2 which is connected to Q1 bar. Okay. We have K2 which is connected to Q1. Okay. All right. So there is a clock which is common that we already shown. J1, K1 are both connected to 1. J2 is coming is the same as Q1 bar. K2 is the same as Q1, and that's it. And we are asked to find what will happen to Q1 and Q2 as time goes. Okay. So let's say we are given that Q1 and Q2 is equal to 0 to begin with. And we are asked to find what happens in the next few cycles. Okay. So I want to do this in detail because if you do a similar problem in class in detail, the students will really benefit from that. And it's not always easy, especially if there are more complex connections. It's not always easy to figure out things unless you do it systematically. So let's just see how to go about this very, very systematically. Okay. So we write the table here for the JK flip-flop. First JK Q. So 1 0, we know the flip flop gets set. 0 1 gets reset. 0 0, same as Qn. 1 1, Qn bar. Okay. So this, when you are doing this kind of a problem on board, it's always good to write this thing in the corner of the board so that for reference. Okay, so that is our table, and we are going to continue to refer to this as we go along. So what do we do next? So let's draw the timing diagram. So this is our, okay, so we are going to draw three things. One is the clock, and so on. Then we will draw Q1, and that is something that we have to figure out what it is. And then we will draw Q. So there is a clock here, Q1, and then we have Q2. And we are given that to begin with, we have Q1 is equal to 0 and Q2 equal to 0. Right? Okay. Now let us see how to go about this. This is a little complex because we have this kind of connection here, and we need to really figure out what is happening to J2 and K2 every time the active clock edge comes. So let's start like this. Let's tabulate the values of J1, K1, J2, K2, and then Q next. Okay, or Qn plus 1. Right? If you do this systematically, and there is no way the students will make any mistake, and that is how we should really do this. Okay. Okay. So J1 and K1 are actually always 1. So in fact, we can fill up this table even without looking at the outputs Q1 and Q2. Right. Here we of course need two of these because there are two flip flops. So Q1 n plus 1 and Q2 n plus 1. Okay. So even without looking at this Q1 Q2 column, we can fill up J1 K1 because they are always tied to 1. So what is going to happen? Q1 is something that we can draw even without looking at Q2 because there is no connection of Q2 with the first flip flop. Alright. So it's simply going to, since J equal to 1, K equal to 1, we are at the last entry of this table, and it's simply going to toggle, keep toggling, okay, irrespective of what is happening at the Q2. And so on. That is given, that we don't really need to think much about. Now the output of the second flip-flop will depend on what Q1 and Q1 bar are, and for that we need to actually compute J J2 and K2, right? So yeah, actually we need some more space. So okay, what we will do is, okay, let me write Q1 and Q2 here in this small space. Hope you can see it. Okay. So I'm going to write Q1 here, Q1 previous and Q2 previous here. Okay. So Q1 previous and Q2 previous to begin with was 0 and 0. So what is J2? And now we need, this is a very important point. We need to look at things just before this active edge, right? So these are our active edges. So we need to look at J2 and K2 and J1 and K1 as well, just before this active edge. So that means what was the situation at J2 and K2 just before the active edge? J2 was getting Q1 bar, which was Q1 was 0, so therefore Q1 bar must have been 1. That is 1, and K2 was getting Q1, which was 0. Right. Now this tells us that the next Q2 would be 1. Right. So now next, and Q1 of course we know that we'll just keep toggling every time. So this has become 1 and 0 and 1 and 0. This table, this column of the table, we can fill up even without any reference to Q2, right. And that we already done in here, done over here in the plot. So now what is the situation? This 1 will actually come here. This become the previous values now, and now we are at this point, right? Now we are looking at, so Q2 has become 1, and now we are looking at just before this edge. That means Q1 is 1 and Q2 is 1, okay? That is what is in this table here. So what is J2? J2 is the same as Q1 bar, which is 0, and K2 is the same as Q1, which is 1. And therefore, this is going to reset the flip flop. Okay. So this is going to reset the flip flop, and you can complete one more cycle, and so on. So now this 0 0 will come here, that these become the previous values now, right? J2 will now become the bar of this, and K2 will become 0. So therefore, the next Q2 will be 1, and so on. So it actually, in this particular example, it turns out that Q1 and Q2 are identical. They are both following the same pattern. Okay. All right. But so the point here is not what the circuit is doing, but how to go about drawing these waveforms. Okay. And this kind of table is very, very important. Without a table, without a systematic approach, you really, one can really easily get lost. So it is better to write down this table and then complete the waveforms. All right. So I think that is probably the last slide of this presentation. Yeah. So that is what is being shown in this table here. Okay, so the final comment is that note that this circuit is not really doing much, as we have seen, because Q1 and Q2 are identical. It's not doing much apart from taxing our minds. But hold on, some useful circuits will appear soon, and that is what we will do in the next presentation. So let me go to the next presentation, and then we will look at, we'll start looking at counters and such. Okay, so let's just continue with JK flip flops. And now before we actually come to some counters, it is important to point out more inputs that a JK flip-flop can have. And those are the reset direct and set direct inputs. These are called asynchronous inputs. And why are they called asynchronous inputs? Because they have nothing to do with the clock. They can override the clock, right? So if for example, set is 0, reset is 1, then that doesn't matter what all other inputs are. So if S is 0, R is 1, it doesn't matter what these others are. and Q n plus 1 becomes, is forced to be 0. If ST is 1, the set direct input is 1, reset input is 0, then it doesn't matter what these are and the flip flop is set to 1. 1 1 of course is invalid because then it's ambiguous. And if both of these are 0, then the normal flip flop operation continues, and that is what we have been assuming in the last presentation. We have assumed that this flip flop is active, that means the set and reset direct inputs have been made inactive. Okay, so then of course if it's a positive edge trigger flip flop, then we show an edge here and then the normal JK flip flop table, that is called normal operation. Alright, so a few points about this slide. Clock flip flops are also provided with asynchronous or direct set and direct reset inputs, SD, RD. They are called by different names. Sometimes it's called preset and clear, which override all other inputs, J, K and clock. Now these inputs in some chips they can be active high, in some other chips they can be active low. So if it is if they are active low, then they are denoted by not SD and RD but SD bar and RD bar. The asynchronous inputs are convenient for starting up a circuit in a known state. When you turn the circuit on, a complex digital circuit on, you can force this all these flip flops into a specific state by using these asynchronous inputs. Otherwise your whole digital system will be in some kind of an uncertain state, which of course we don't want. Alright, so there is then the D flip flop, which is a special case of a JK flip flop, with K and J and K being inverse of each other, and again that can come in two varieties, the positive clock, positive edge triggered D flip flop or negative edge triggered D flip flop. And so you can actually look up the or draw the JK flip flop table at this point and show that if this connection is made, then only J equal to 1, K equal to 0 or J equal to 0, K equal to 1 entry, those are relevant, and that corresponds to this table. If D is 0, then Qn plus 1 is supposed to be 0. If D is 1, Qn plus 1 is supposed to be 1. So what is the D flip flop doing? It is actually essentially causing a delay of 1 clock pulse between the input and output. For example, in this case, the input is like this, and the output this will appear at the output one cycle later, and that is because as we have been repeatedly stressing, we need to look at things just prior to the active edge. Okay, so just prior to this active edge, D is 1, so therefore just after the active edge, D will become 1 here. So therefore, in other words, it will introduce a delay of 1 clock cycle. Okay, there is a shift register. Now again this the font size may be a little small for you, but let's just look at the waveforms, you might be able to see those. So there is a shift register in which there are 4 D flip flops with inputs D1, D2, D3, D4 and outputs Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. There is a clock given and the input at the first D input is given. So that is what this looks like. Okay. And now we are asked to plot Q1, Q2, Q3 and Q4. All right. So you can actually work out such a problem in class so that the students get a feel for what a D flip flop does, and this can be done one at a time because this D is going to act as an input to this flip flop, and that alone is going to determine what happens to Q1. This Q1 is going to act as an input to this second flip flop, and that alone is going to determine what Q2 looks like, and so forth and so on. So therefore we can do this one at a time. So Q1, the moment D is given, Q1 is known. The difference between the input and the output here is that this output Q1 gets sort of synced with the active edge of the clock, which in this case is negative, right? So the active edge here is negative, and therefore it is getting synced with Q1 has got synced with the active edge here. Okay. Next we have Q2, and Q2 is a delayed version of Q3 and so on. So essentially the data is just shifting. So Q4 is a delayed version of Q3, which is a delayed version of Q2 and so on. Now this can be actually represented in a little transition diagram like that, and it's maybe a little, the font size again may be a problem for you, but just look at it later, and it is convenient to show in class if you want to. Okay, this shows the movements of the data, how that goes through the various stages, and we can try to explain this figure in class. Okay. There is something called parallel transfer between shift registers, and you often need to do that if there is if you are doing some operation in which there is a shift register involved. That shift register you want to load initially with some data, so that is where this is important. So there is a register A here, the top one, and there is a register B, the bottom, and what we want to do is there is some data in A already, and that data we want to shift, we want to transfer to the B register. Okay, so that can be done by connecting this output of the first flip flop here to the input of the first flip flop here, and so on. The second flip flop, the output goes to the second, the input of the second flip flop here, and so on. So now what will happen is one clock edge, the active edge, will essentially make this transfer, make this top data transfer to the bottom data. That is called parallel transfer between shift registers. Okay. You can also explain what a bi-directional shift register is, and it's with some simple logic you can actually achieve this job. So what is doing here, what is done here is there is a DR, an input data write, that means this is going to shift right. There is a mode input, and there is a DL or data left, this is going to shift left, and it's sort of simple, it's easy to see how this works. If mode is 1, then these top gates are actually activated, and this mode bar is going to the bottom gates, okay, the bottom AND gates. So if mode is 1, only the top gate is sort of passing these values, and the bottom gates are just putting out zeros. So if mode is 1, this input is 0 here, this input is 0 here, and so on. And the data then will, this DR will come here. And this output of this one then will come here, and so on. If mode is 0, then mode bar is 1, and then the bottom gates now are active, and then this DL is now connected to the last flip flop here. The output of this flip flop is connected to the input of this flip flop, and so on. And so now you see that this, the data will flow in that direction. Okay, so we'll take a look at, take a more detailed look at this later, and you'll figure out it's pretty easy to understand this circuit. Okay, so that's called a bi-directional shift register. There's a very very interesting application of shift registers, and that is multiplication using shift and add. Now this is of course a little too small for you to see perhaps, but you can take this example and explain how multiplication can be done by doing simply shift and add. So this on the right we actually show that procedure in detail. So maybe you can see at least this part. So we are essentially multiplying two numbers. One is 1011 binary, that is decimal 11. The other one is 1101, that is decimal 13. And how do we do this? First we load this top number here, 1011, and that is being done here. That is loaded, the first number is loaded here, 1011. Then what we do is we look at, okay, we load this second one with zeros, and that those are these zeros, right? And now since B1 is 0, I think this in this table the one step is skipped. So just look at this part, and then you can actually correlate the left and the right. And so what is happening is here we are taking this, the contents of the first register, shifting it left, then doing an add, then the contents of the register we are again shifting left. Whenever you shift left, you are padding these things with these zeros. Those are these Z's here. And then finally, when all of these after 4 clock cycles, you will get your result. So that is what is shown in this table here, the step by step procedure. And in fact, there is a very useful, very interesting hardware experiment that you can set up with this. So you can ask the students to multiply 2 4 bit numbers using this process. It's a fairly involved circuit, but it can be done in about 3 hours time. So you can set up an experiment based on this algorithm. It's nothing but what we do in decimal numbers as well. Right? We take one of these numbers one at a time, then we pad that with zeros, we go on adding and so on. It's the same thing in binary as well. So we'll take a look at this example in more detail later. Alright. Now parallel in, serial out data movement. So sometimes what we want to do is there is some data that we want to load into a shift register, and then we want to shift it either right or left. Okay. So that is what is shown here. So there is a clear pulse. The clear pulse will essentially clear it, that clear line is going to all of the reset inputs. That will just clear all the flip-flops. Then there is a load pulse. That load pulse is going to these gates here. So what that will do is, if your A3 for example was 1, then it will load this flip-flop with 1. If A2 was 1, it will load that with 1, otherwise with 0 and so on. So this, after the load pulse, these flip-flops will actually have the data that is applied here to these AND gates. So that data will come here, and now we want to shift it. So then after that, both the clear and load inputs are inactive. That means this ST and RD, the set direct and reset direct, are now inactive, and therefore the normal operation of the flip-flops will continue, and the flip-flops will start seeing the clocks and so on. Okay, so then the clock is shown over here, and as a result of this clock, then this normal shift register will work. And this actually is shown here in pictorial form. Okay, so let's say this is our data. So this circles could be either 1 or 0. Now step number 1 is to load this data. So that is what that does. Step number, then after that, after every clock pulse, this data will keep getting shifted, right? Like that. And finally, of course, since this input is connected to 0, all this 0 will, this 0 will essentially come to all of these flip-flops.